Hi, I'm Dr. Shobha Shankar, professor in the Department of Electrical Electronics Engineering, Vidyavardhaka College of Engineering, Mysore. So in this session, we will see how unit commitment table can be modified, taking into account the reliability considerations. So far in the previous session, we have seen how are we able to arrive at unit commitment table or decision, taking into account only the economic considerations. So in this session, we will see how UC table can be modified when reliability is considered. So we know that in the current scenario, the dependence on electricity has increased. This is mainly because of the comforts what we have at the household, or because of the increasing dependence on industry, agriculture, and etc. Because of all these reasons, the reliability of power system has assumed great importance. Electric utility is under obligation to provide continuity and quality of service to its customers. Therefore, economy and reliability must be properly coordinated to arrive at UC decision. So previously we have seen how economic considerations are taken into account while preparing the unit commitment table. So in this session, we will also take into account the reliability considerations. So accordingly, we are going to modify the unit commitment table while taking into account the reliability considerations. So in arriving at the economic UC decision at any particular time, the constraint what we are taking into account is the fact that total capacity on the line is at least equal to the load. And if one or more of the units were to fail, we know that in power system, we cannot assume that all the generators will be working all the time. So if for any reason, if any one of the generators is not working or it is on forced outage, then we won't be able to meet the load requirements. So, and in addition, in order to start a thermal unit and in order to bring it on to steam, it will take few hours. And therefore, for that particular time period, we may not be able to meet the load. Further, the capacity of the units on the line must have a definite margin over the load requirements at all the time. This is mainly taking into account the contingencies and as well as the additional requirement of the load, because we don't know what would be the load, and load cannot be static all the time. It is dynamic in nature. The load keeps varying. And also there are chances of any contingencies in the power system. So considering these into account, we need to ensure that the capacity, the generating capacity over the load requirements. So with this, we can ensure that always the load can be satisfied. So this additional margin over the load would be called as spinning reserve. So patterns analytical approach is one of the methods to determine the system's spinning reserve at any time. So we will see the formula, what is the analytical approach and how are we able to arrive at the system's spinning reserve at any point of time. And since the probability of the outage increases with the operating time, and since a unit which is to provide the spinning reserve at a particular time has to be started several hours ahead, especially if it's a thermal unit, I cannot ensure that if I start the thermal unit at this instant, there is no guarantee that it can immediately can be considered for the generation, because it takes several hours in order to ensure that we have a specific output of this unit. So therefore, loads are not known with complete certainty, and therefore we need to ensure that always there is additional generation which is over and above the load. This we call it as spinning reserve. A simplified version of the problem is presented here. So a unit during its lifespan undergoes alternate periods of operation as well as repair. So in this figure, you can observe the random unit performance record neglecting scheduled outages. So scheduled outages are known for us because for this particular time period, I can identify which unit needs to be taken out for maintenance. So which we call it as scheduled outage. Suppose if any of the generating units need to be taken out for repair, then I can well in advance schedule that for that particular time period, this generator won't be, need not be considered for generation. So for scheduled outages, if it is known well in advance and if it is neglected, then we can have few of the units which would be functioning, and because of failure or any outages, that unit may go out of order. So we, therefore, in order to bring it back to starting position, that unit needs to be repaired. So this is what is shown in repair, or which we also call it as downtime. And if that unit is in on position, we call it as uptime or upstate. So we have two states, namely upstate and downstate. So if the generating unit is in the starting position, so we call it as the generator is on or the uptime. If it is shut down for repair, then it is called downtime, or maybe because of some failures. The lengths of individual operating and repair periods are random phenomena, with operating periods being much longer than the repair periods. So we also know that the time taken to repair a unit normally is very less as compared to the time for which the unit would be in the uptime or in the on state. So when a unit has been operating of a long time, the random phenomena can be described by the following parameters. There are few parameters based on which we are able to calculate the mean time to failure. So mean time to failure is given by T up, is given by sum of the individual time for which the unit is in upstate divided by the number of cycles. So if you refer to the previous figure, you can observe that for this time period, it is in upstate. So you can observe for this state, it is up. So for this state, it is up. Again, here again, it is in upstate. So I can add these states together divided by total number of cycles. So in order to find out the mean time to failure, or which is also called as mean uptime. Mean uptime is given by T up is equal to summation of the intervals for which that unit is in the upstate or uptime divided by total number of cycles. Similarly, mean time to repair or mean downtime can be expressed as, so we can call that as the time period for which the unit is down. So T down is given by sum of the intervals for which that particular unit is in downtime divided by total number of cycles. So this is T up time and this is T down time. So mean cycle time can therefore be expressed as total uptime plus total downtime. So total uptime is the time interval for which the unit is in upstate divided by the number of cycles. Similarly, total downtime, which is also called as mean time to repair, can be defined as the sum of the intervals for which that unit is in downtime divided by number of cycles. So put together, we can call it as mean cycle time. So inverse of these times can be defined as rates, which we call it as failure rate lambda. So failure rate lambda is nothing but the reciprocal, or the one divided by mean time to repair, or the, I'm sorry, mean time to failure, which we call it as uptime. So therefore, failure rate lambda is equal to 1 divided by mean time to failure, which is nothing but the mean uptime. Similarly, we also have repair rate, so mu, which is nothing but the reciprocal of the mean time to repair, that is the mean downtime. So mean downtime, reciprocal of that would be called as repair rate, and the mean uptime would be called it as the failure rate, that is the reciprocal. So failure and repair rates are to be estimated from the past data for the individual units. So by the definition of probability, the probability of a unit being in up or down states at any time is expressed as, so the probability of a unit being in up state or down state is given by, so the probability of the unit being in up state is given by the total mean time, mean up time divided by the total cycle time. So which is nothing but the up time plus down time. So which is nothing but mu divided by mu plus lambda. Or mean down, the probability of the unit being in down state is given by the total down state divided by the total mean time, total cycle, mean cycle time, that is total up time plus total down time. So lambda divided by mu plus lambda. And we also know that the probability of the unit being in up state plus the down state will be equal to 1. Because if the probability of the unit being in up state is 1, then the for down state it would be 0. Therefore, it would be equal to, the sum would be equal to 1. So probability of the unit being in up or down are also called as availability and unavailability respectively. So this I can also call it as availability, and this we can call it as unavailability. So let us now assume that there are k units which are operating. The system state changes because of random outages, because we cannot predict which unit will be going out of order. So therefore it would be the random outage. If a particular system state I is defined as xi units in down state and yi in up state, then k is given by xi plus yi. That is, the probability of the system being in this state is given by, so probability pi is given by the product of, sum of the products of that unit being in up state and the product of the unit being in down state. So now we will come across Patton's security function. So wherein using this function, this is an analytical approach for finding out the spinning reserve. So a breach of system security is defined as some intolerable or undesirable condition. So when we say the breach of security, it is mainly the insufficient generation capacity. If the system is able to meet the load always, then we say that the system is secure. Or otherwise, if there is insufficient generation capacity, then we can say that there is breach of security or the system is insecure. So Patton's security function quantitatively estimates the probability that available generation capacity at a particular hour is less than the system load at that time, and it is defined as, so Patton's security function is given by summation of probability of the system being in state I into probability of that system state that causes breach of system security. So Patton's security function, which calculates the spinning reserve, can be, the spinning reserve is nothing but the additional generation capacity over and above the load requirement. So S is given by summation of pi into ri, wherein pi is the probability of the state being in state I. So, and the ri is the probability of that system state I, which causes breach of system security. So when system load is deterministic, that is completely known, there is no uncertainty, then ri is equal to 1 if available capacity is less than the load, and otherwise it is 0. And S is a quantitative estimate of system insecurity. So S is a quantitative, we are able to measure in terms of quantity. So whether the system is in secure state or in insecurity state. Next we have security constrained optimal unit commitment. So we know that in unit commitment, we are mainly interested in identifying which are the units which should be turned on in order to meet the specified load requirement, either for a day or for a week or for a month. And unit commitment is an important tool for independent system operator to obtain the economical generation schedules in a day ahead or week ahead of that electric power plant. So once the units to be committed at a particular load level are known, from economic considerations, then the security function S is computed as, so as we have already seen the pattern security function, S is equal to summation pi ri. So wherein pi represents the probability of that unit being in state I, and ri is the probability of that unit being breaching that secure state. So the security function should not exceed a certain maximum tolerable insecurity level, so which we call it as MTIL, that is maximum tolerable insecurity level. So MTIL for a given system is management decision which is guided by past experience. So for any system, it is mainly a basically a management decision, and it is based on the previous experience. If the value of S exceeds the maximum tolerable insecurity level, then the economic unit commitment schedule is modified by bringing in the next most economical unit as per the unit commitment table, and S can be recalculated and checked again. Because suppose if the security function exceeds this maximum tolerable insecurity level, then the system will not be secure. So since we are calculating the unit commitment table taking into account both economy and reliability, therefore we need to take into account the security of the system. So this process is continued till we check whether S is always less than or equal to the maximum tolerable insecurity level. So to understand this better, let us consider four units, and let us assume that this is the daily load for the system, and the economically optimal unit commitment for this load curve is obtained by the use of the unit commitment table, so which is based on the economic considerations. And let us assume that this is the status of the units for minimum operating cost. So this is the unit commitment table which is prepared based on the economic considerations. So since there are four units, you can observe that in a day of a time, that is over 24 hours, you can observe that we can have a maximum load range. So each unit can take for this interval of time. So we have four units, the load in megawatt is specified. So we can go up to a maximum load of 20 megawatt corresponding to this time period, that is 0 to 4 hours, and correspondingly up to 24 hours, we have the load curve. The daily load curve is given for us, based on which, based on the economic considerations, we are able to arrive at the number of units which needs to be turned on depending upon the least operating cost. And this is the economically optimal UC table, taking into account the periods A, B, C, D, E, and F. So you can observe this. These are the periods what we have, A, B, C, D, E, and F. For these periods, we are able to identify the units which needs to be turned on or committed based on the economic considerations. So economically optimal UC table is this. And wherein in the economically optimal UC table, we are taking into account the security also into account. So let us now check if the shown optimal UC table is secure in every period of load curve. This needs to be checked for each and every interval or period. So we have shown six periods in the daily load curve, A, B, C, D, E, and F. According to these periods, now we need to identify whether this economically optimal UC table is secure in each and every period. Let us say you can observe that in the first row, for the period A, we are committing unit 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now we need to ensure for this period A whether this table is secure for this particular period. So for a minimum load of, if you can observe the daily load curve, you can observe that the minimum load is 5 and the maximum load is 20 megawatt. So for a minimum load of 5 megawatt, according to optimal UC table for period E, only one unit needs to be operated. Unit 1 needs to be operated, assuming identical failure rate lambda of 1 per year and repair rate mu of 99 per year for all 4 units. And let us also assume that maximum tolerable insecure limit to be 0.005. So with this assumption, we are able to check whether this calculated economically optimal UC table is secure for each and every period A, B, C, D, E, and F. So let us now check for this period E, wherein only one unit needs to be operated. And unit one, we know that it can be in only two states, either operating state or otherwise outage state. Outage means it is not in working condition, whereas in operating state, it is in working condition. So for a minimum load of 5 megawatt, according to optimal UC table for period E, you can observe that we have identified unit 1 and all other units are shown to be 0, which means to say that they are not working, they are not committed. Only unit 1 needs to be in on state, whereas all other can be in 0 state or off state. So assuming identical failure rate lambda of 1 per year and repair rate of 99 as discussed previously and with MTIL of 0.005. So we can now calculate the security function S. So wherein security function can be now calculated as summation PIRI. So since we are considering only unit 1, it can be in any one state. So P1, that is P up, the probability of that unit being in upstate is given by mu divided by mu plus lambda, so which is equal to 0.99. And the probability of that unit being in downstate is given by lambda divided by mu plus lambda. So the probability of the unit being in downstate is very less, whereas the probability of the unit being in upstate is more. So it is 0.99, whereas this is 0.01. So R1 is equal to 0, whereas R2 is equal to 1. So with unit 1 down, the load demand cannot be met. So S is given by 0.99 into 0 plus 0.01 into 1, which is equal to 0.01, which is greater than 0.005. So therefore, thus when unit 1 alone supplies 5 megawatt load, it fails to satisfy the prescribed security criterion. According to the prescribed security criterion, if we are able to calculate analytical approach of a security function, it is seen that or observed that S is greater than 0.005, which should have been less than or equal to 0.005 for the system to be secure, which is not so. So in order to obtain optimal and yet secure unit commitment, it is necessary to run the next most economical unit. That is, unit 2 needs to be operated along with unit 1. So when both units 1 and 2 are operating, the security function is contributed only by state when both the units are on forced outages. The states with both units operating or either one failed can meet the load of 5 megawatt and does not contribute to the security function. Therefore, you can now check that when we are including the second unit also to be working along with one, and if we are able to calculate the pattern security function, S, which is equal to the probability of the unit being in downstate, the first unit and the second unit, so we get S to be equal to 0.001, which is less than the maximum tolerable insecure limit. So therefore, you can now observe that previously we had committed only unit 1 corresponding to this period E. Now, in addition to this, we are also taking into account the second unit also. This is because if only the first unit is supplying for the 5 megawatt, which is the minimum load, and by any chance, if this unit is not working, is under forced outage, then we may not be able to meet the load. And therefore, in order to ensure that system will be still secure, we are taking into account the second unit also. So together, when unit 1 and unit 2 are operated for this particular period E, then we can observe that the system will remain secure by calculating the security function which is found to be less than the maximum tolerable insecure limit. Similarly, we can check the security function for other periods A, B, C, D, and F. And we can arrive at the optimal and secure unit commitment table according to the sample load curve which we have considered. So lastly, we have the startup consideration. So in addition into taking into account the probability of the unit going out of order, that is forced outage, we will also take into account the startup consideration. So the unit commitment table as obtained above is secure and economically optimal over each individual period of the load curve. Such a table may require certain units which needs to be started and stopped more than once. Therefore, startup cost must be taken into consideration from the point of view of overall economy. So while arriving at this combination, that is both unit 1 and unit 2 being committed for this particular period E, we also need to take into account, suppose if we have many such combinations of units which needs to be operated over various time periods, then we can observe that some of the units may be turned off and turned on from one period to the other. Therefore, we also need to take into account the startup cost that is involved while turning on and off that particular unit. So unit 3 has to be stopped and restarted twice during the cycle. You can observe here, for the period A, unit 3 is in on state. Again, for B, it is still in on, whereas for C, it is turned off. And again for D, for this period D, you can observe that unit 3 is again started. So when unit 3 is again started, so it incurs that startup cost. So therefore, when we are taking into account the economic considerations, the startup cost needs to be considered. So we must therefore examine whether or not it will be more economical to avoid one restarting by continuously running that unit corresponding to period C. So suppose if this unit 3, which was started and it is remaining in on state for period A as well as for B, if it can remain in on state for period C also without burdening on the economy, then for D also we can still continue it to remain in on. Only for E state and F state it can be turned off. So wherein we are able to reduce this switching over from on to off state and off to on state. And if this startup cost is less as compared to the unit being remaining in on state, then we can go ahead with that decision. So let us now consider case one, when unit 3 is not operating in period C. So the total fuel cost for period B, C, D as obtained by most economic load sharing are shown here. So this is the total fuel cost corresponding to period B, period C, period B, C, E, B, C, D. So this is for period B, this is for C, and this is for D. We are not shown the complete computation here. And the startup cost of unit 3 is, let us say, rupees 50. Then the total operating cost would be, total operating cost would be this. So which would be small as compared to that unit being changing from off to on or from on to off. So when all the three units are running in period C, unit 3 is not stopped at the end of period 3. So we can observe that even with unit 3 remaining in on state, there is still, it still results in overall economy. Therefore, the optimal and secure unit commitment table for this load cycle is modified as under with due consideration of the overall cost. So depending upon the transition cost from on to off or on off to on, we can decide and we can arrive at the economical unit, optimal unit commitment table. Thank you. Thank you.